light as we approach this lesson tonight, because I definitely don't want the devil to have no victory. Amen. Amen. There are so many things that this lesson will help every believer who wants to live a victorious life in Christ Jesus. And if the truth be made known, all of us do want to live in victory. But living in victory requires something. Living in victory requires something. And we have to be aware of the wiles of the devil, the stratagems, the schemes, the trickery of the devil. And the more we become aware of it and where he attacks, the better we can live in victory, or the better we can discern him when he's coming. It doesn't matter how he's dressed up, because you know he can transform himself into an angel of light. He can transform himself into a preacher or prophet. But it doesn't matter how he becomes dressed up. Once we have the discernment to focus in and recognize what he is doing to us, then we can apply the word of God in certain areas in our lives where we can then appropriate what is already ours. Because the truth be made known, you have victory. But many of us are not living in victory. You have victory, but we're not living in victory because we have not appropriated what God has for us. Can you say amen?
Amen.
All right. I want you to go to Ephesians. Chapter 6. That has been our launching pad. And then we'll look at our intro here, because there are several things I just want to point out, take my time and point that out, and then move through these 6 points in which we can use as weapons in our arsenal against an awesome force. Amen. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, Paul writes, "My brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, purpose that ye may be able to stand." Literally, if you look at all of what Paul is going to say, it centralizes on standing. Touch your neighbor and say, it centralizes on standing. All right, you're with me now. Against the wiles, schemes, stratagems, artifice of the devil. He is a trickery one. Okay? "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of the darkness of," hear the text, "this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." Let's read verse 13. "Wherefore, take," that's a command, "unto you the" what? "Whole armor of God." Here it is. Here it again is the purpose. "That ye may be able to withstand in the evil days, having done all to stand." Father God, I pray tonight that you would bless us with the insight that we need in order to protect ourselves against this awesome foe. Help us to use all the weapons you have made available to our disposal, because we are in Christ Jesus. Forgive us now of our sins, and clearly speak to our hearts again about what you have given us in Christ. And then, Lord, allow us to employ these weapons properly for the good and glory of your kingdom. In Jesus' name, come on, shout amen.
Amen.
Amen. Now look on to your intro. All too frequently, people run to one of two extremes in their thinking about Satan and his attacks on the believer. Some become overoccupied with him, and as a result, see Satan actively and intimately concerned with every problem or situation that goes wrong in their lives. We need to remember that within our own being is the capacity to intimate, promote, and commit sin. That in our own being, in our own fleshly self, without Satan at all, is the capacity to commit sin. The world system is designed against God. So without Satan, there are other things that can cause us to get off track. But being overly occupied with Satan can also lead to critical introspection, in which not only every action, but also every motive is minutely examined in the light of Satan's possibility. Now, on the other hand, this undue concern with Satan can sometimes provide a person with unjustified excuses for their action. Oh, Satan did it because it becomes an out for that person to relieve him of the responsibility of committing sin. Is that Flip Wilson theology? The devil made me do it. You know, sometimes we'll just say that and we'll just do what we want to do. But of course, Satan does it through the person who is involved in the responsibility for the action and not against his will. Now that says the devil may use me, but I'm still responsible for my action. It's not against my will. I've decided to cooperate with Satan. Or I decided to cooperate with demonic forces. Turn over there, page 2. In contrast to an overoccupation with Satan, there is the opposite attitude that underestimates his activity in the believer's life. Undoubtedly, this really pleases Satan because we tend to promote a kind of illusion that, you know, the devil is not really involved here. He did not really cause this problem. And for the believer not to recognize the source of a problem, he has no way properly to attack the problem. Are you thinking with me? He may say it was just a coincidence or it was just a natural phenomenon, but in reality, it's the devil in his house, it's the devil in his job, it's the devil in his finances. The devil is all over the place. And you know, there are places and areas the devil is smart about attacking. For instance, he can attack us with personal emotional difficulty. He can discourage us. He can place stress on our life. He can place anxiety in our life. He can attack us with small problems in the church. He can make us major on the minor and minor on the majors. He can make us argue over tablecloths, light bulbs, scarf, little things. And people who are looking for a church, a place where they can rest their weary souls, won't rest their souls in a place where there's a lot of confusion. So the devil knows how to get us in the church. He can make us function on suspicion, make us function on gossip, make us just throw out innuendos loosely and lightly about individuals, causing them major hurt in their personal lives. He knows how to use our mouths. Adverse circumstances can be in our lives, but we seldom credit these things or attribute these things to Satan. Now, sometimes to contribute everything to Satan can seem to be foolish, but at other times to contribute nothing to Satan is foolish. Somewhere in between these two polars, the devil made me did it, I did it on my own. Satan is involved in this. He's not involved in this. We need to find a balance. That's what we're trying to achieve tonight, a balance to understand where he attacks and what we can do. We need to be alert to all Satan's possible devices, for he is at work attacking, deceiving, counterfeiting, and he is seeking to defeat a believer at every opportunity. He does not sleep. Every opportunity, he's seeking to defeat you. All right? So thank God we're not left defenseless. But God has made some provisions for these attacks. Let's kind of just look at this and work our way through this and see what provisions God has made for these attacks. The first thing you need to look at is number one. In two places in the New Testament, we are told that Jesus Christ, that our Lord Jesus, lives in heaven to make intercessions for his children. Let's just go to one of them. Let's go to Hebrews, just as we just roll through this. Hebrews 7:25, which is a great one. Hebrews 7:25, awesome one. Look at that. I want you to read that because you need to see that. You need to get that in your spirit. A believer needs to be armed with this verse in his life. Wherefore, Hebrews 7:25, wherefore, he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come to God by him. He is able to save us to the what? To the utmost, to those that come to God by him, that is Christ, seeing he ever liveth to make what? Intercessions for us. Christ is living right now to make an intercession for you. Christ is looking at your life. He's viewing your circumstances, and he stands ready to help you. You've got to understand that whenever you're talking about the devil, you are not in this thing alone. Hey, look at this. Apparently, this work of praying for us has two aspects. It is curative, and it's also preventative. It's what? Curative. And it's also preventative. How do we mean by curative? Number one, curative is necessary to sustain fellowship when we sin. Can't go to 1 John 2:1, but you can read that. The preventative helps keep us from sinning. When I sin, it's curative because Christ is an advocate to help me to regain and sustain my fellowship with God. So I don't have to be defeated when I fall. Is everybody thinking with me? But it is preventative because there are some attacks that the devil plans for my life. Christ wards them off. He stands in front of Satan and says, you can't put that on my child. So he helps keep us from sinning. There are some things that are too heavy for me to bear. And he doesn't allow the devil to place those things on my life. You've got to remember the Lord will never put more on you than you can bear. Wherever you are right now, wherever you're going through, he has weighed it and tried it in the balance. He understands you can bear it. Are you thinking with me? All right. Particularly when Satan, we are attacked by Satan. He knows what you can handle. All right. A, the word evil as it appears in this verse that is, as it appears in John 17:15, can be either neuter, that is evil things. The devil can bring some evil things in our lives. Or it can be masculine, evil one. That is, it is related to Satan. Sound room. It's related to Satan. We've got to be careful. When evil comes, Christ stands as an intercessor to keep us from evil things and to keep us from the evil one. Christ is asking the Father to keep to guard the believer. He literally stands and builds a fence around the believer. Eternally, your soul is kept. Everybody who has been born again, your soul is kept. Satan cannot touch your soul. Now you got to understand that right away. He can never touch the soul of man. You can see that in Job. Okay? So the first thing we have as our weapon of arsenal is Christ. He never slumbers nor sleeps. He never takes a vacation on this. He's always aware of what's going on in your life. every day, at all times, he knows. And so you've got to be aware of that. When I fall, he stands as a priest, ready for me, ready to put me back into fellowship with God. Now, when Satan comes with a major attack on my life, he stands as a soldier and says, you can't do that to my child. Amen. Now, you got to realize that the Lord will not put no more on you than you can what? Amen. All right, you with me. Number two, the second line of defense for the believer is to know that the purposes of God may on occasion include using Satan to teach a particular lesson. Now, the best way to describe this, before we even get into what we got down there, the best way to describe this is the devil is on a leash. He on a chain. You ever seen one, you know, you walking down the street and all of a sudden the dog starts barking, you don't know where he comes from, starts running out and that chain just grabbing. The devil is just on a chain. He starts to bark and holler, you jump, you get ready to run, that chain hooks you. He can only go so far. And sometimes God will use him because we're being rebellious, because we're being stiff-necked, because we're doing some things that we understand and know are against the will of God. And God will step in and say, hey, hold it. You can be turned over to the devil, and he'll let the devil teach you a quick lesson or two. Let's look at that. In some instances, our defense is to learn the lesson God has for us, even though he may be using Satan. I'm going through a difficult time in my life. I'm going through an unusual time in my life. There are things happening in my life that are quite unusual to me. Is God trying to get your attention? Please ask that question. Don't go through anything that's unusual in your life, that's not normal in your life, and don't ask yourself, is God trying to get your attention? Because God will get, let me say this again, God will get your attention. He will send you through some things, and ultimately the Bible says he can bring you home. He can bring you home to get your attention. He can bring you to his office to get your attention. He can make you sit down at the table with him in heaven to get your attention. So he will get my attention. He'll get your attention. And sometimes things happen to me. I say, God, are you trying to teach me something here? Be open to that. Amen. Amen. All right. He using Satan in the process of teaching it. For example, what God did, in the case of Job, when he permitted Satan to be used to carry out his own purposes in Job's life. God permitted Satan to be used to carry out his own purposes in Job's life. Now, when we read about Job, we hear he was perfect and upright. But that does not mean that Job had arrived. He still had some growing, some more maturing, some more lessons to learn. And God allowed Satan to come in and buffet him. Now see, sometimes believers, we think we ain't gonna go through nothing. We start to bind this gospel of profit, of commerce. You know, it's gonna be all pie in the sky. And God will permit the devil to buffet you to show you that you've got some things to go through. But he allowed you to go through those things because God wants to see whether or not you're going to trust him. Some of us going to trust the Lord as long as money is in our pocket. Some of us going to trust the Lord as long as our lights are on. Some of us going to trust the Lord as long as we're moving up on our job. But God wants to know, come what may, from day to day, are you going to say that you are a child of God when you're up? Are you going to say you are a child of God when you're down? Are you going to say that you are a child of God when you're in? Are you going to say you're a child of God when you're out? That's what God wants to know. And he has a way of finding it out. Some of us are going to be believers as long as things are going right with us. We use God like a 911 service. When we got a problem, we call him. You know, when we get a flat, we want him to come fix it. That's how we use God like a butler today. You know, when we need something, we call him in the room for him to come service us. But God wants a relationship that goes beyond that. You don't just call me when you need me. You ought to be serving me every day. Is everybody with me here? All right. Now look at that. He talked to Paul, number two. A similar thing happened in Paul's life, and you can read it there for yourself, when the Lord sent a messenger of Satan to inflict some kind of thorn on him in order to keep him from getting proud over the revelations God had given him. Sometimes, believers, the Lord will help us stay on the straight and narrow. And it can get real thorny, if you will, when you step out of God's will. He can really begin to poke and jug you. It can be just like a thorn in your side. Every time you step out of God's will, you can feel the pressure. You can feel God being an antagonist to your soul. And he's saying to you, get back in my will. Get back in my will. And every time you seem to try to slide out and think nobody's looking, he is. And he puts a disturbance underneath your soul. You think everybody knows, but it's only between you and God. God is trying to say to you, you need to get back in the will of God. Just a little thorn, just a little pressure he puts on you to keep us humble in his will, not for us to get too arrogant and too proud. Now the lesson Paul learned was the sufficiency of God's grace. That wherever we are, whatever we've experienced, God can sustain us. I wish I had somebody. God can keep us. God can hold us. God can bring us out. God can bring us through. We've got to understand that I'll experience nothing in this life that God's grace is not sufficient. It's not more than enough, JD, to keep me while I'm going through it. You got to have that kind of faith. You know, God can put me, listen, God can take me all the way up the ladder. I mean, put me on the top of the world. It may seem like a whole lot to me, but God can hold me there. God can allow me to go to the depths. I mean to the lowest rung in life. But while I'm on the lowest rung in life, God can hold me there. Yeah, he can hold me. I don't care what the devil put me through, what the world put me through, he's sufficient. All right, he's interceding for us. He sometimes uses, say, number three, it is always of primary importance in defeating Satan to take the proper attitude in relationship to him. Uh-huh. Satan is no chump. He's no chump. And for those of us who are unwilling to read the Bible, he's going to get the best of us. Unwilling to read scripture, he's going to get us. Unwilling to pray, he's going to get us. Unwilling to build within our lives a routine of prayer, of Bible reading, and consistently being in fellowship, the devil or his demons will get the best of us. Nobody is excluded from prayer, not even Jesus. Nobody is excluded from the word, not even the Lord. I mean, he knew it, but he studied it, and he taught it. You got to understand that. Jesus himself, Luke, read it in your Bible. As it was his custom, he entered into the synagogue. You and I need fellowship among one another in order to keep promoting, to keep stimulating us on the right road, to do the right thing. I need to hear from you. You need to hear from me. I need to see you. You need to see me in order for me to stay on the straight and narrow. Your presence humbles me, keeps me right. It reminds me of who I am. That I am a child of God and you are a child of God. That's why I keep coming. You get off track. You got to be careful. Got to be careful. He ain't no chump now. All right. All right. Let me see where I am. I'm about to throw myself off here. He's no chump. Hey. Though we have the power of God on our side, It is never wise to assume. To assume that victory is automatically guaranteed. There's a whole lot of people shouting victory. They live a defeated life. Because it's not guaranteed, children. We've got to stay focused and understand that the devil has more schemes and tricks than we can think about. So it is not guaranteed. Number one. Remember that we are engaged in a mighty foe. He's got about 6,000 years of experience. He's listening to where your weak points really are. And normally, he's going to hit you with what you used to do. He's going to bring by the right person. You know what I'm talking about. Well, there's a male or female going to come knocking at your door at the right time. You know, when things are already going bad, that's when they go knock. Not when things are going right. You see, the devil, he don't fight fair. He'll kick you when you're down. He'll kick you when you slip. So he's going to get you in that position. He is a slick one, and he knows how to get you. He came and got Eve when Adam was away. So he knows when you're weak. He knows when you're going through something. You can expect him to knock on your door at that time. He's a mighty foe. He knows how to work on me and you. The greatest of all God's creatures. That's true. And it is, I'm sorry, the greatest of all God's creatures is to assume a proper attitude towards Satan. And when you read Jude 9, you'll see that the archangel Michael told the devil, now he's a powerful angel, but he told the devil, the Lord rebuke you. You see, we've got to realize we got to put God on Satan. Not our own energy. Not our own effort. We've got to get some God in our lives in order to win this war. And if no God is in our lives, we are not going to have confidence to fight. Somebody ought to hear me today. So once I've got God in my life, once I'm walking in the straight and narrow, even though I'm going through a difficult time, even though I've done the things that God would have me to do, once I'm walking in that way and Satan attacks me, I've got the confidence that the Lord is with me. But now when I'm hooking and crooking in my own flesh and the devil comes knock on the door, I've got very little confidence that the Lord will help me out. So it's always important to be in God's way no matter what I'm going through, because I'll have the confidence that God will help me in that situation. Amen. All right, number four. Be careful now, he's no chump. And I think some of us have underestimated him. Number four, a definite stance against Satan on the part of a believer is essential for victory. Stand up and be counted. Today we got so many believers that they won't even be counted for the things of God. Serve food, they all want to be counted. Make sure they got their ticket. Call for a fast, they don't want to have nothing to do with it. You really ought to hear me today. Anytime we got something to do that will tickle our pleasure, everybody want to be involved. But they say it's prayer time. Well, I'll see y'all later. You need to learn to stand up and be counted for God. No matter where you are in your relationship with him. I just started to fast. I don't know how to fast. I've never fast. Join the rank of those who believe in Christ. I just started to pray. I'm not a great prayer warrior. All I know is a few words. Say those in the name of Jesus. Stand up and be counted. Nowadays, it's just showing up that really makes a difference. Hey, is it self-evident? Yes, it is. It's self-evident. But many Christians will never realize victory over the devil simply because they have never decided. That's it. They haven't even decided that I'm coming to Sunday school. They haven't decided that they're going to be faithful to Bible study. They haven't decided that they're going to have a prayer life. They haven't decided that they're going to have a prayer partner. They haven't decided that fellowship is an essential part of my life. I can't do without it. See, I've made those decisions. I've decided I can't make it without Jesus.
I've decided that I need to be among the redeemed. I've decided I need prayer in my life. I've decided I need the word. And without the word, I'm losing ground. Have you decided? Come on. Be serious with you. Have you decided? Have you made the decision that that Jesus is my choice? I'm going with him. I may fall, but I'm going to get back up. I'm going to keep walking with the King for the rest of my life. A whole lot of people are not going to, really, a whole lot of people are not going to experience success in no area of their lives because they have not decided. Having decided to have a good marriage, having decided to be a good father, a good mother, having decided they're going to do a great job on their job, having decided that they're going to do the best in school, they have just not decided. No success. When you look back, they can hardly remember those areas in their life. With no great joy, because they have not decided. Make a decision. Make a decision. The devil got us now. We're so uncommitted to everything. My God. Lord, have mercy. Make a decision. They never decided to take a stance against him. B, they are still flirting with the sin or temptation Satan puts in their path. Still walking on that edge. You know what I'm talking about. You know, just going in the wrong places all the time. Lord have mercy. I don't know if you ought to stay for another movie, because you know we already get, you know, it's getting warm up in here. Just flirting. Don't want to admit you're weak. Let me tell you, I got news for you. That I'm just weak without him. The flesh is weak. But the spirit is weak. You know, the devil's biggest enemy is your pride. I mean, his biggest weapon is your pride. He can make you try to thank you all that as a believer. Get you caught all out on that limb and then saw it off, as daddy used to say. Make you think you got it together. You can handle anything. I can't handle anything. You can't handle anything. You and I both need the Lord. You can't do nothing without God. So he's going to try to get you to strip off some Jesus where you're going. And the moment you strip that Jesus off, he got a little crink in your armor, and he's going to shoot you right there. Just a little chink. That's all he needs. Just a little crack. Make you think you all that I can handle it. You're already, the flesh is already bubbling, you trying to deal with it. Yeah. Oh, help me, Jesus. Yeah. I'm by myself. That ain't never happened to you. Many Christians in their heart pray earnestly for victory and speak sincerely of their desire for relief, but still indulge or yield to some pet sin. You know, we think we've only coined little white lies. We coined more than that. We got some little things we do, and those little things get in our way. And once we do them, they get in our way of serving God. Because we don't feel like serving now, because we feel like we messed up, we're unworthy. We need to confess and get back into service. But you got to watch out for that little thing that you reserve just for you. That you think ain't nobody watching, ain't nobody got no eye on you doing this. And that little thing gets a stronghold in your life. Oh, you need to hear me. You need to hear me. I don't care how many, let me say this. And maybe it's not popular for a pastor to say. I don't care how many times you fall. You need to get back up and ask God to forgive you. I'm not trying to say that grace is cheap, but I've got to say that he has enough forgiveness in the cross of Christ for every sin. I've got to say that you will ever commit. So you've fallen on your face time and time again. The cross is still there. The cross is still there. He's still waiting for you to believe and appropriate the victory that you need in Christ Jesus. I got to move on. I can't stay long now. Somebody going to think I'm trying to cheapen the grace of God. No, I'm not. Okay, B. The second element in the formula is something we can do
Wait a minute, I'm ahead of y'all. I done jumped way ahead of y'all. No. Two. I done flipped my pages and everything. Two. James wrote of this using a verb tense that means to take a decisive stand. When he said, resist. Resist doesn't mean, oh, Lord, I don't know. Oh, God, help me. That's not what it means. It means take a stand. I don't want to do it, Lord. I don't want to go that way. And sometimes you can't just take a stand. You got to flee. Is anybody going to think with me? And when you flee him, God will help you in that situation. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Take a stand. And I know the devil just must be laughing at us like it's a comedy hour, because some of us won't take a stand. As soon as he dangle a little carrot in front of us, we haven't decided to really follow Jesus. Oh yeah, we want to go to heaven. Oh yeah, we want our sins forgiven. But now every now and then, just that little pet piece of cake. Anybody know what I'm talking about? He'll just dangle in front of us, and he must be laughing, because he keeps saying all you need to do is take a stand. Just say, I'm not going that way no more. Take the stand. You go that way, still take the stand. Get up, ask God to forgive you, but take the stand. My God, today. My God, number five. Don't get out of here. Started late, but we're going to get out of here. Five. A rather simple and concise formula for defeating Satan. Let's go to it. It's given in Revelations 12 and 11. Let's go to it. Man, I tell you, God's been so good. All right. Listen to the text. And they overcame him. That's the devil. By the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Ooh, Jesus. And listen, they loved not their lives unto the death. Here it is, a real simple formula here. You got it? You got it. Let's go to eight. The first basis of victory over Satan is the blood of the Lamb. The blood of the Lamb. That is, the crucified Christ, listen to this, has defeated Satan. Don't miss that. The crucified Christ has defeated Satan. Everybody that's covered by the blood, the devil already knows he's on a leash. He already knows he can only go so far. And most of the time, he ain't doing nothing but bluffing most of us. Making us think he got all power. He ain't all powerful. Christ is all powerful. The devil nothing but a roaring lion with his teeth plucked. Just making a whole lot of noise. You know how a lion traps his prey? That big old king of the jungle gets on one side, start doing all the roaring on one side, runs his prey right into a whole group of animals, a whole group of other animals on the other side. And sometimes the devil ain't doing nothing but roaring, making you run into a trap. That's all he doing. He already know he is a defeated foe. We give him too much power at times. He ain't got that much power. And based on the cross of Christ, he ain't got no power in my life. You've got to say that. If you've been by the cross of Christ, the devil has no power. He will open his mouth. He will form a weapon against you, but no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Roaring lion, but his teeth been what? Plucked. Please understand that. The second element in the formula is something we can do to make Christ's victory applicable in our lives. Be positive. Believers, be positive. Be consistent.
Believers need to learn to be positive. I need to stop right here and park, but I ain't gonna park long. You need to learn to be positive. We can be positive about everything. But when we get to the church, we can be negative at times. We don't need to be negative either at church or on ourselves. Learn to be positive. Now, it's not out of the will of God to smile sometimes. It's not out of the will of God to hold your head up when you're going through a difficult moment. Be consistent. Watch the text. Watch the text. Watch the text. Why, Pastor, be positive, be consistent. In your testimony for the Lord. Sometimes we ruin our testimony in Christ by being negative. And you know we ruin our testimony in Christ by being inconsistent. Inconsistent in our walk, inconsistent in our talk, inconsistent in our lifestyle, our testimony. And I really don't want to say a testimony is ruined, but folk can't really believe what we're saying based on what they're seeing. I mean, it's not that you haven't been redeemed. It's not that the Lord hadn't brought you out. It's not that you haven't come out the wilderness, but you look like you fell back in the forest. You just got the look on you. And because you look like it, somebody is not going to see the validity of what you're saying. But now let me say something to you right now. I don't care how many times you fall. If you know that you know that you know that you know you've been born again. Everywhere you go, you ought to tell somebody that the Lord has saved me. I ain't perfect. I don't want you to look on me. I want you to look on the Savior that's in me. I want you to look on that cross, because the same power that saved me is the same power that can save you. You can take the light off. You put the light on Jesus. But you ought to say, everywhere you go, I've been saved. Or not be ashamed of it. I don't care what folk know about you. I don't care what they know about your past. I don't care what they know you've done. I've been saved. Saved folk make mistakes. But I've been born again. I know the day I've been by the cross. I know the day I saw the Savior's face. I remember the hour he came into my heart and forgave me of my sins. I am saved. Nothing will take that out your mouth. Down and out, caught with the bag in your hand. I can say a few other things. But y'all tell folks, I've been born again. But the Lord has secured my soul for all of eternity. I made a mistake. You can't put this on Jesus. Put it on me. But I've been saved. Just because I'm saved, sometimes I don't always act saved, but I'm saved. Keep your testimony. Don't let nobody steal it from you now. It is a fatal mistake to believe that while faith in the death of Christ is required, the testimony of Christ is optional. It's not. It's not. Sometimes the moment you walk in the room and say, yeah, I'm saved, they start putting up the drinks, putting up the reefers, putting up everything. Yeah, I'm a believer. Yeah, I believe in this. But because you put the light under the tree or under the bushel, folk just start having a party. Why, you right there. They ask you, do you want to take a hit of this? You ain't let them know you were Savior. You didn't let them know you were born again. If you'd have told them, they might have put it out. Tell them you're saved now. I'm saved. Yeah, I'm saved. The Lord stand by you. All right, third feature of the formula for victory is a basic attitude toward life. It's an attitude of self-sacrifice to the point of being perfectly willing to die for Christ. You ain't got to die for the Lord. It's the attitude that he's first in my life. It's really just that attitude. Jesus is so far on the back burner in some people's life, if they had to go to court and prove that they were a Christian, they'd be found guilty of not being one. Because he's not first. And when you look in that checkbook, where's the Lord? He ain't there. You look in their home, where's the Lord? He ain't there. Look how they're using their time. Where's the Lord? He's the last thing on their agenda. You see, this group of people decided he's first. Have you decided God's first?
That's the major question in our lives today. Finally, let's get to this, because my God, I don't know if I need to deal with this. But let's deal with a couple of them. Let's go quickly through them. Let me read right through them, and then I'll come back over it. How about that? Finally, victory over Satan requires the constant use of the armor which God has provided for the Christian. You can read that. A. Let's go through this real quick. You with me? All right. This includes truth which, like a girdle, holds everything together and gives proper orientation to life. Truth, God's truth, not mother wit, not what you learn on the street. Ain't none of that stuff holding life. Most of that stuff is messing life up. This holds life together. Let's go B. Righteousness is the breastplate to God, the vital organs of life. Most of your vital organs are right up in here. So it guards against you being wounded, a vital wound against these organs. You got me? All right, let's go to C. I got to move fast. Our feet should be prepared to do the will and work of God because we have experienced the peace of God which brings the gospel. You've been saved, you ought to try to get somebody else to know about the grace of God. You ought to be willing to use your feet to go tell somebody. I'm moving fast here. Listen to me, because this is central truth. Faith is a large shield that gives overall, belief in God is a shield that gives overall protection from the devil. The one thing the devil wants to do is to make you doubt. Just doubt God. You're just right where he wants you to be. Your shield is down, and he's going to attack you. So God says, take this shield of faith. It's overall protection. Move, come on, we're moving. All right. This is not simply faith in the crisis of life. That's what most of us do. But faith to overcome the tempter in the routine of life. Every day, I need faith. Are you with me? All right. The helmet of salvation, that thing that goes on your head. The helmet of salvation goes around the head to protect us from a vital blow. All right, don't take but one blow to that head. Over. You got it? Are you clear? When you're saved, there can be no vital blows that the devil can hit you with. Got to remember that. Got to remember that. This is one of those Jeremiah illustrations. If you're reading me, he's a picturesque prophet. When you're saved, there can be no vital blows to your life that the devil can hit you with. Y'all, I be stressed out all on the prayer like the devil going to just ruin you. No, he can't do it. Because you got the helmet of what? Remember that. All right, I got to move fast here. Come on. Turn the page. The single offensive weapon is the sword of the Spirit, which is what? So that's the one weapon you can use to hit him back with. But if you're not in the Word, he's just punching at you. Let me say that again. If you're not in the Word, you're defenseless. You know, you just took the sword out your hand, and all he's doing is just knocking you with a whole lot of blows. You can't hit him back. Because you're not in the Word. It's like you get in the ring with your hands tied and the other person ready to box. And you're trying to box, you're just trying to defend yourself. But they're swinging at you. You don't have the ability. That's why most of us live in defeated lives. We're not serious about it. Until you get. He's sitting up in your living room laughing at you, just punching you. Punching your mouth. You can't do nothing. Punching your side. You can't do nothing. You got to pick up this. You got to follow this. That's when you start to hitting them back. Somebody ought to help me here. All right. This is not simply, watch this, the written word. For the particular word used here and translated word means spoken word. So when he hits you, you ain't studied nothing.
I can steal your salvation. You ain't stealing nothing. You ain't got nothing to say about that. I'm going to take all your money. You're going to lose your job. You ain't studying that. You can't say nothing to him about that. You're going to lose your mind. You ain't studying that. You can listen. You thinking you're going to lose your mind. I don't know how many believers I've met. They're going to lose their mind. But Isaiah said, if I keep my mind on him, he will keep me in perfect peace. But you ain't studying nothing. And the peace of God shall guard your heart and your mind. God is standing on guard at my heart and my mind. I don't care how much pressure is on my life. But I said it there. I can't believe it. Oh, I'm about to lose my mind. I'm like, oh my God, I want to give up verse so bad. Losing your mind. Not for no devil. Can make you lose nothing. Help me, Lord Jesus. All right, finally. The final feature of the armor is prayer. Not just mouthing petitions, but spirit. Look at me. Spirit guided prayer. Not just, you know, if you're all programmed to pray, you ought to ask the Lord before you get up to guide you. You don't got to pray no lengthy prayer. Just guide me. Guide me in what I'm going to put before the king. And then he is the king. That means that every resource you can imagine that's at Bush's disposal, every resource you can imagine is at his disposal. That and more is at the king's disposal. He ain't got to consult with no cabinet. He ain't got to go through no legislative body. He doesn't have to go through no judicial branch. He is the king. And what the king says, and see, prayer is like going in the throne room and having an appointment with the king. And so an angel would say, but scarce you next to go see the king. And see, when you go see the king, that's praying. And so when you go see the king, you need to ask the king for what you need. Somebody missed that. I said, he's the king. King of heaven and earth. There is nothing that's not under his authority. He is the spirit-guided prayer. Puts me in the throne room. Before the king. All right, let's conclude. Two sentences. This is the armor provided for our protection, but God will not forcibly dress us up. Not gonna do that. Everything I said, you got to put on. You got to put it on. You got to put on from the first piece to the last piece. You got to put on the truth. Because the devil is the author of a what? Lie. If you ain't putting on the truth, you walking in them. Put it on so you can defeat him. You got to put on righteousness. I'm not just talking about what you do. I'm talking about what God has already given to you. Just put it on. A lot of times, if we just put on doing right, we give the devil no options. Is anybody thinking with me? Just put it on. Pick up faith. Don't put it down. In everything in life, apply your faith. Because the devil's weapon is doubt. Are you thinking with me? Where you going with these? Are you trying to share the gospel with somebody? Are you trying to tell somebody about Jesus? The God you know? What he has done for you? How good it has been to you? Why don't you share it? That sword. Don't let him just beat you up. Pull out that sword. Let's get it on, though. I got the word, I'm on with it. What God has given me, I'll use that. You know, you don't need but a verse to whoop Satan. All Jesus used was a fraction of a verse. And he whooped Satan every time he came. You know, but listen, man should I live by bread alone, but by every word of God.
He just whipped him with a fraction of a verse. All you need is a verse. Pick up that sword. Pray in the. Remember, you before the king in his throne room, and there's nothing God can't grant you. Nothing. It's about us close. Let's just say really quick. Say a word of prayer. I'm going to take a couple of questions. I know we're running late, but somebody may want to ask me a vital question. Let me say a word of prayer. Father, thank you that you stand as an intercessor, ever living, always available. You never slumber nor sleep. You see our every activity. We're never out of your sight, never away from your presence. You are always there. Lord, help us to grab these truths in our heart and remember that you are there. Help us not to underestimate Satan. He's a formidable foe, but God, help us to stand against him in the name of Jesus. Well, Father, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would allow us to put on your whole armor by faith in obedience to you, that we might be able to stand against this adversary and all of his imps. In the name of Jesus, bless us tonight to remember that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And every time we pray in the Spirit, we are standing before the King, making our request known. We can do it with boldness, and you will help us with mercy and grace. Thank you now for everyone that's here tonight. Let this word be imprinted in our hearts in Jesus' name. Come on, say amen.
I hope the days come easy and the moments pass slow, and each road leads you where you wanna go. And if you're faced with a choice and you have to choose, I hope you choose the one that means the most to you. And if one door opens to another door closed, I hope you keep on walking till you find the window. If it's cold outside, show the world the warmth of your smile. But more than anything, more than anything, my wish for you is that this life becomes all that you want it to. Your dreams stay big, your worries stay small. You never need to carry more than you can hold. And while you're out there getting where you're getting to, I hope you know somebody loves you and wants the same thing. But you never forget all the ones who love you in the place you left. I hope you always forgive and you never regret, and you help somebody every chance you get. Oh, you find God's grace in every mistake, and always give more than you take. But more than anything, yeah, more than anything, that this life